Good morning, New Hope Church family. I'm glad to be here with you this morning. As you can see this morning, I'm broadcasting live from my home office, also known as my garage. And this morning, we're going to be finishing up the covenant of grace. We'll be looking at the Mosaic covenant, the Davidic covenant, and then the New Covenant. And so excited to be able to work through that with you. And hope you're enjoying these lessons on the covenant of grace.
Well, as we get going this morning, just a reminder as to where we've been. We started in the covenant of works, and then we've been in the covenant of grace for a couple weeks. We did an overview, and then we started to work through the different administrations, with Adam, with Noah, and with Abraham. And then now we're going to finish up the covenant of grace, and then next week we'll be in the covenant of redemption. Before we get going, I'd just like to open us up in prayer, so if you would please pray with me. Gracious God, we give you thanks for your goodness toward us. God, we thank you for your word, that you've given us your word, that we can come to your word and you reveal yourself to us. We're so grateful for your mercy in that. God, be with us today. Open up our eyes that we may behold wonderful things from your word, that we may behold wonderful things from understanding how you have worked out your plan of redemption for us. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So the first thing I want us to look at today is the gospel narrative, the big picture. Pastor David, last week we were in a meeting and he reminded me of this, but there's a way that we can remember sort of the biblical story or the narrative of the gospel. And it's really with four letters, but it's four letters that make up words. And so it's creation, fall, redemption, and restoration. And so this is a real simple way for us to understand God's grand plan for all of his creation. And so God created all things in the beginning. Of course, the fall, Adam and Eve, we talked about that, covenant of works and all that stuff. And then from then on, the covenant of grace comes in, and God in the covenant of grace is working out his plan of redemption. Okay, and so he's doing that now, currently in our lives, and then ultimately one day God will restore all things, and he will bring in the new creation. And so this is just a really good way to be able to think about the biblical story, and then also to think about within the God's great plan of redemption, each of the different administrations of the one covenant of grace, they play a very integral part in God's grand plan. And so as we work through each of the individual covenants in the one covenant of grace, we can see more and more, like we talked about, that flower as it's blooming, as it's blossoming, as it's opening up, as we go from Adam to Noah to Abraham to Moses to David, and then ultimately into the new covenant, we see how God has worked all things together for our good and for his glory. So as we get started this morning, I do just want to mention also, because I am in my home office, I apologize if there's any other noises and distractions that come along, and hopefully it won't be too bad. So the first thing we're going to look at this morning is the Mosaic covenant, or the Sinaitic covenant. And so the first thing I'd like to point out is that this is a continuation of the one covenant of grace that was established with Abraham. Okay, it's not something brand new in the fact that God is relating to his people differently. It's a continuation of the covenant. Gerhardus Voss says that the Sinaitic covenant is not a new covenant as it concerns the essence of the matter, but the old covenant of grace established with Abraham in a somewhat changed form. O'Palmer Robertson also says, historically, the nation of Israel already was in a covenantal relationship with the Lord through Abraham. Okay, and so what I want us to see is that as we enter into the Mosaic covenant, the Mosaic administration, it all hinges around the promises that were made to Abraham originally, and so we can see the continuity through that. Okay, and so the first thing as we look at the continuation of the Abrahamic covenant is to see that God promises Abraham that he would have many offspring. This is in Genesis 15:5. And he brought him outside and he said, look toward heaven and number the stars if you're able to number them. And he said to him, so shall your offspring be. And so when we look at the nation of Israel, this is a promise made to Abraham that he was going to have many, many children, many, many sons and daughters. Secondly, God promises Abraham that his offspring would be enslaved, but eventually they'd be set free. We see this also in Genesis 15. Then the Lord said to Abram, "Know for certain that your offspring will be sojourners in a land that is not theirs, and will be servants there, and they will be afflicted for 400 years. But I will bring judgment on the nation that they serve, and afterward they shall come out with great possessions." And so long before the people were ever enslaved in Egypt, God made a promise. God foresaw these things, foretold these things to Abraham, and so they weren't surprised. It wasn't something that God didn't expect. It was a part of his grand plan of redemption. Thirdly, God promises to establish the covenant with his offspring after him. So with Abraham's offspring after him. Okay, and so God's going to extend those promises to his offspring. We see this in Genesis 17. "And I will establish my covenant between me and you and your offspring after you throughout their generations for an everlasting covenant to be God to you and to your offspring." In that last part, we see the covenantal formula. "I will be your God and you will be my people." And so God has promised Abraham that he's going to extend the covenant to his offspring. And so we see that as we enter into the Mosaic covenant. Just as we continue going through these promises, next, God promises to give Abraham and his offspring the land of Canaan. Okay, and this is it. We see this in Genesis 17. "And I will give to you and your offspring after you the land of your sojournings, all the land of Canaan, for an everlasting possession, and I will be their God." Again, the covenant formula. And so when the people are enslaved in Egypt and God delivers them out to bring them into the promised land, it's something that he's already promised to Abraham. And so again, the covenant of grace formally established with Abraham as we get into Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. It's a continuation of this, of these promises, of this covenant originally made to Abraham. Also, we see that God promises to establish his covenant with Isaac specifically. Okay, Genesis 17, God said, "No, but Sarah, your wife, shall bear you a son, and you shall call his name Isaac. I will establish my covenant with him as an everlasting covenant for his offspring after him." And so the covenant is established with Isaac specifically. And the Lord God appeared to Isaac. This is later on, at the end, toward the end of Genesis, and told Isaac, "Do not go down to Egypt. Dwell in the land of which I shall tell you. Sojourn in this land, and I will be with you, and will bless you. For to you and to your offspring I will give all these lands." And so we see these promises carrying on to Isaac. We also see that God carries out his promises through Jacob, and so the same covenant going from Abraham to Isaac, now to Jacob. And so Genesis 35, "And God said to him," to Jacob, "your name is Jacob. No longer shall your name be called Jacob, but Israel shall be your name. So he called his name Israel. And God said to him, I am God Almighty. Be fruitful and multiply. A nation and a company of nations shall come from you, and kings shall come from your own body. And the land that I give to Abraham and Isaac, I will give to you and to your offspring after you." And so again, we see this process, right, from Abraham to Isaac to Jacob, and these promises are building, and now he's changed Jacob's name to Israel, and so now we have this nation, right, God's people. They're already God's people, okay, and so that's kind of the key, is they're already God's people. They're already a part of those covenantal promises. And then the next thing I want us to see is, as we get into Exodus, God remembers his covenant with Abraham. Okay, and so again, it's not that God's doing something entirely new. He remembers his covenant. Exodus 2:23-25. "During those many days, the king of Egypt died, and the people of Israel groaned because of their slavery and cried out for help. Their cry for rescue from slavery came up to God, and God heard their groaning, and God remembered his covenant with Abraham and Isaac and Jacob. And God saw the people of Israel, and God knew." And so this is fulfilling what God has already promised Abraham, right, that his family would be enslaved, okay? Also in Deuteronomy, "See, I have set the land before you. Go in and take possession of the land that the Lord swore to your fathers, to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob, to give them and to their offspring after them." And so again, it's not something new. It's something that's based upon the covenant that's been working through Abraham, through Isaac, and through Jacob. Okay. The next thing I would like us to look at as it pertains to the Mosaic covenant is the law. This is a key because I think a lot of people may see the Mosaic covenant as something different because of the law. But again, what we need to remember is that Israel became God's people by grace and not by works of the law. The law was given after God chose and delivered Israel, right? And so on the one hand, God's law is not something new. God always had his law. I mean, it reflects his character, but it was formally given after God delivered his people from Egypt. And so Gerhardus Voss says, the children of Israel were in the covenant when they set out from Egypt. Precisely because they were in it, they were delivered from Egypt. There was not one word mentioned of a new relationship. And so they were delivered because of grace, not because of their merit, right? Not because of law keeping. They were delivered because of grace. O. Palmer Robertson says, after God has established himself as Israel's Lord through the historical fact of the deliverance from Egypt, the law covenant of Sinai is administered. And so it's after God has already established himself as Israel's Lord. We see this in Exodus and in Deuteronomy. God says, I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. And then he goes into the Ten Commandments, right? And so he delivered them by grace. They're his by grace. And now I give you these laws, just like Richard and David have been teaching us through their preaching through Deuteronomy. And so their relationship is based on grace, okay? The next thing I want us to note is the purpose of the law within the covenant of grace. Louis Burkhoff says, the law served a twofold purpose in connection with the covenant of grace. One, to increase the consciousness of sin, and two, to be a tutor unto Christ. The Reformed tradition really holds to three uses of the law as it pertains to how we are involved in the covenant of grace, how we are as Christians. The three uses are the moral use, the pedagogical, and the ceremonial. So the moral use, that is as a rule of life, how we are to reflect the character of God, how we are to walk in holiness. The law reflects God's character, and as we obey the law, we are walking in holiness and reflecting the character of God in our lives. Second, the pedagogical. This is how the law points out our sin and drives us as a teacher toward Christ, right? And so as we look at the law, it serves as a mirror to show us where we fall short, because none of us can uphold the law. And so it drives us to Christ. And then thirdly is the ceremonial use of the law. And this was established in the Mosaic Covenant. And it was only for that period of time up until Christ. When Christ has come, the ceremonial use of the law is abrogated, because Christ has fulfilled all that the sacrifices and the ceremonies pointed to. They all pointed forward to Christ. Robertson says, by exposing fully men's inadequacy to establish righteousness by law keeping, the Mosaic Covenant has contributed to the cause of redemptive grace. The law nonetheless served to sketch the pattern of life desired for God's people. They are to be characterized by life that reflects the holiness of the God of the covenant. And so Robertson points out how the Mosaic Covenant has contributed to the cause of redemptive grace. It points to Christ, the law points to Christ, and is a guide for holy living. Next, just want to point out the ceremonial and typical service in the law. I already mentioned that, but as far as the ceremonies, the types, the shadows, the sacrifices, all of those things point to Christ, who is the fulfillment, who's the fullness of all those types and shadows. With that, Gerhardus Voss says that a formal gospel preaching was offered continually by symbols and types. This is through the law. A priestly class came into existence. So in the Mosaic Covenant, we see a formal gospel preaching offered by types and symbols. And then also the priestly class, which points forward to, number one, Christ as the ultimate sacrifice. And then number two, as our great high priest. Next, as we've gone through the other covenants, I just hopefully you know, we've been able to see Christ in every covenant. And so now we want to look at Christ as well in the Mosaic covenant. And so first, we see Christ represented through types and shadows. Okay, again, we were just chatting about that, just talking about that. All the sacrifices, all the things, all the rituals, all of that pointed to Christ. There's two major ones that I really want to point out and that I want us to look at this morning. The first is the Passover. So Exodus 12:5 and 7-13. This is speaking of the Passover. As you all know, when the night that God delivered Egypt or Israel out of Egypt. And so this is what God says: "Your lamb shall be without blemish, and they shall take some of the blood and put it on the two doorposts and in the lintel of the houses in which they eat. They shall eat the flesh that night, roast it on fire with unleavened bread and bitter herbs. They shall eat it. Do not eat any of it raw or boiled in water, but roasted, its head with its legs and its inner parts. And you shall let none of it remain until morning. Anything that remains until morning you shall burn. In this manner you shall eat it, with your belt fastened, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand. And you shall eat it with haste. It is the Lord's Passover. For I will pass through the land of Egypt that night, and I will strike all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, both man and beast. And on the gods of Egypt I will execute judgments. I am the Lord. The blood shall be a sign for you on the houses where you are. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you, and no plague will befall you to destroy you when I strike Egypt in the land." Okay, and so the Passover was this great sign of redemption, right? It is the thing that the straw that broke the camel's back to that Pharaoh would allow the people of Israel to leave Egypt. And so what we need to understand is that this Passover lamb as a type and a shadow points forward to Christ. And we see this in John chapter 1, when John the Baptist sees Jesus. He says, "The next day he saw Jesus coming toward him and said, 'Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world.'" Okay, also 1 Corinthians 5:7, Paul writes, "For Christ, our Passover lamb, has been sacrificed." And so just as in Egypt, when the Israelites put the blood over their door, the angel of death passed over and did not kill the firstborn. And so in the very same way, when we are covered in Christ's blood by faith, our sins are passed over. And so Christ is our Passover lamb. Herman Vitsius also says, let's see if I can go back there. "For Christ, our Passover lamb," he discusses the mystery of Christ as Passover lamb in four ways. One, in his very person, right? Two, he describes him in his sufferings. Three, in the fruits that he bore for us. And four, in how we are partakers of the promises through the Passover. Okay, the next key in the Mosaic covenant is the Day of Atonement. This is in Leviticus 16. So Leviticus 16, 5 through 10, 14 through 16, and 21 through 22. "And he shall take from the congregation of the people of Israel two male goats for a sin offering, and one ram for a burnt offering." And this is the high priest. "Aaron shall offer the bull as a sin offering for himself and make atonement for himself and for his house. And he shall take two goats and set them before the Lord at the entrance of the tent. And Aaron shall cast lots over the goats, one for the Lord and one for Azazel. And Aaron shall present the goat on which the lot fell for the Lord and use it as a sin offering. But the goat on which the lot fell for Azazel shall be presented alive before the Lord to make atonement over it, that it may be sent away into the wilderness to Azazel. And he shall take some of the bull and sprinkle it with his finger on the front of the mercy seat on the east side, and in front of the mercy seat shall sprinkle some of the bull with his finger seven times. Then he shall kill the goat of the sin offering that is for the people and bring its blood inside the veil and do with its blood as he did with the blood of the bull, sprinkling it over the mercy seat in front of the mercy seat. Thus he shall make atonement for the holy place because of the uncleanness of the people." And I'll skip forward. "And Aaron shall lay both his hands on the head of the live goat and confess over it all the iniquities of the people and all their transgressions and all their sins. And he shall put them on the head of the goat and send it away into the wilderness by the hand of a man who is in readiness. The goat shall bear all their iniquities." And so two things really to point out here. One is to note the sprinkled blood on the mercy seat. And so as we as we look for where is Christ in this Day of Atonement, okay, the sprinkled blood on the mercy seat. I think a couple of keys. One, Aaron's the high priest, right? Christ is our grace high priest. He goes into the Holy of Holies right before the Ark of the Covenant. And what's interesting, what's really cool, is the mercy seat, okay, in the Greek translation of the Old Testament, the Septuagint, the word is helasterion, okay? And this is the very same word that is used in the in our ESVs, translated as propitiation, okay? And so, like in Romans 3:23, where it says, "For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God and are justified by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ, whom God put forward as a propitiation by his blood." That's the word helasterion. And so Christ, his blood, is on the mercy seat, right? The helasterion. He makes atonement for our sins. And so I think that's a key connection there. The mercy seat, the helasterion, Christ, where Christ is sacrificed. And then secondly, the picture of the scapegoat. Okay, that's the goat sent into the wilderness to Azazel. And so this is the idea where our sins are placed on Christ and carried away from us. John T. Rhodes says, "The two goats are a great picture of what Christ, the true Lamb of God, will later do for his people. He will take on himself their sins and carry them away, but at the cost of his own life." And so we see all of this pictured in the Mosaic covenant, especially in the Passover and the Day of Atonement, the helasterion, the mercy seat, and Christ being the propitiation, the helasterion for our sins, and then also too as the scapegoat. And then lastly, I just want to mention that we also see Christ represented within the covenant curses, as Christ is the curse bearer of all the curses that are within the covenant. Robertson says, "Christ fulfilled all righteousness. He kept the whole law perfectly while at the same time bearing in himself the curses of the law. From every perspective, the covenant of law consummates in Jesus Christ." Okay, so Passover and Day of Atonement. The next thing that we want to look at is faith represented in the Mosaic Covenant. Okay, just like we saw through Adam and through Noah and through Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, faith. Remember, faith is the condition of the covenant. And so Robertson says, "Throughout the Mosaic period of law covenant, God considered as righteous everyone who believed in him." Similarly, Rhodes said, he writes, "The covenant at Mount Sinai is and remains a covenant of grace. This means that the condition was the same as with Abraham, namely faith." Okay, and so just like in all the covenants, the condition of the covenant, we read in the Westminster Confession, the condition is faith. Remember, faith is a meritorious condition. It's not something that we merit access to God. It's something that is given, is produced in us by grace, regeneration, all a gift, but at the very same time, it is the means by which we lay hold of Christ and enter into the covenant of grace. We see this in Hebrews pointed out. Hebrews 11, I think we've talked about this the whole way through, but we see this. It says, "By faith, Moses, when he was born, was hidden for 3 months by his parents because they saw the child was beautiful and they were not afraid of the king's edict. By faith, Moses, when he was grown up, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to be mistreated with the people of God than to enjoy the fleeting pleasures of sin." I'm going to skip forward. "By faith, he left Egypt, not being afraid of the anger of the king, for he endured as seeing him who is invisible. By faith, he kept the Passover and sprinkled the blood so that the destroyer of the firstborn might not touch them. By faith, the people crossed the Red Sea on dry land, but the Egyptians, when they attempted to do the same, were drowned." And so we see by faith, by faith, by faith, by faith. It's always by faith, okay? It wasn't all of a sudden now in the Mosaic covenant by law keeping. It was by faith. It is by faith. What's important to note within the Mosaic covenant, and really throughout all the covenants, faith always manifests itself in obedience. Rhodes writes, "True faith is always accompanied by obedience. Not perfect obedience, certainly, but obedience nonetheless." And so we see this throughout this passage in Hebrew, right? In Hebrews, his parents did something by faith. Moses, he did something because of his faith, right? He left Egypt. The people left Egypt. They kept the Passover by faith. They crossed the Red Sea by faith. It was always by faith. So we also see within the Mosaic Covenant, obedience carried out in holy living. We see obedience carried out as they follow the sacrifices and the ceremonies. Rhodes says also that the Israelites were called to trust in God's provision of forgiveness, take him as their Lord. In other words, they had to trust and obey. It was a case of repentance and faith. And so even within the Mosaic Covenant, it was always about repentance and faith. Okay, and so again, Christ is in the covenant, faith is in the covenant, grace, of course, is in the covenant with Moses. Next, we're going to go forward to the Davidic covenant. And so, again, what I hope that we can see in the Davidic covenant is that it is a continuation of the one covenant of grace established with Abraham. Okay, so first thing is we see that God promises nations and kings to Abraham. We see this in Genesis 17:6. I will make you exceedingly fruitful. I will make you into nations, and kings shall come from you. Again, it's not something totally new that God is treating his people differently or acting in a new way with his people. It's something that he's promised long ago that he's fulfilling. The flower is slowly opening and opening, and the people are seeing more and more of the great bloom. Also, we see within the Abrahamic administration, God establishes Judah as the kingly line. And so we see this, you know, the covenant passed from Abraham to Isaac and to Jacob. And now here at the end of Genesis, Jacob is blessing all his sons. And he says this, Judah, your brother shall praise you. Your hand shall be on the neck of your enemies. Your father's sons shall bow down before you. Judah is a lion's cub. From the prey, my son, you have gone up. He stooped down, he crouched as a lion and as a lioness. Who dares rouse him? The scepter shall not depart from Judah, nor the ruler's staff from between his feet, until tribute comes to him, and to him shall be the obedience of the peoples. And so we see at the end of Genesis, before any dealings with the Mosaic Covenant, this kingly line promise, this line of Judah, and ultimately this is fulfilled in Christ, right? The ultimate fulfillment is in Christ. We see this Romans 1 chapter 3, it says, you know, Paul starts out, I, Paul, an apostle, set apart for the gospel of God, concerning his son, who is descended from David, according to the flesh, right? David, from the line of Judah, the kingly line, okay? And so, again, we see that historical continuation of the one covenant of grace established with David. It's not something new. It's growing. It's becoming more and more full. So let's look specifically at God's covenant with David. First thing to see is God's grace toward David. Remember, God initiates the relationship. 2 Samuel 7, 8, 9. Now, therefore, thus you shall say to my servant David, thus says the Lord of hosts, I took you from the pasture, from following the sheep, that you should be prince over my people Israel, and I have been with you wherever you went, and have cut off all your enemies. And so it was God who initiated. God came and took David from the pasture. God gave David the throne. It wasn't that David rose up on his own merit and his own strength. It was that God, by his grace, chose and built up David. We also see within the Davidic covenant that God promises to David an eternal kingdom. And so later in the same chapter, moreover, the Lord declares to you that the Lord will make you a house. When your days are fulfilled and you lie down with your fathers, I will raise up your offspring after you, who shall come from your body, and I will establish his kingdom. He shall build a house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. I will be to him a father, and he shall be to me a son. When he commits iniquity, I will discipline him with the rod of men and with the stripes of the sons of men, but my steadfast love will not depart from him, as I take it from Saul, whom I put away before you. And your house and your kingdom shall be made sure forever before me. Your throne should be established forever. And so God establishes this kingly throne. I'm going to probably mention this a few times, but one of the things that's been a real blessing to me is to see all these promises in the Old Testament and to see Christ as the fulfillment of all of these things. It's just amazing that this kingship promise, this sonship promise, I mean, it's Christ, the Son, right? The eternal King, okay? And that kind of sets the stage for Christ in the Davidic covenant, looking specifically at the picture of Christ within this Davidic covenant. First, we see the covenant king. The Davidic covenant sets up kingship, the king, as the covenant mediator. And so in the Mosaic covenant, you know, we saw the law, the ceremonies, all those things were set up. The nation of Israel was established, right? God set apart a people, a holy people, a holy nation. Now God sets up this kingship idea, this king as the covenant mediator, the mediator of the covenant. Robertson says, the king of Israel maintains a unique role in relations to the covenant. To be king in Israel is to be in covenant relation to Yahweh. The two positions are related inseparably, okay? He goes on to say, in his office as covenant mediator, the king not only represents God in his authority as covenant lord to the people, he also represents the people to God as head of the people. He embodies them and their cause. And so Robertson used the word head there, covenant head. This idea relates to Christ's role as our covenant king. I think it's 1 Timothy. Christ is the mediator between God and man. Christ is our covenant head, right? The head of the covenant of grace, as Adam was our head in the covenant of works. Christ embodies us and our cause before the Father within the covenant of grace. And so that we see Christ pictured there. Robertson also says the dual responsibility of covenant mediator relates particularly to the king's position as son to God. As son, he shares the throne with God, his Father. As son, he possesses the privileges of perpetual access to the Father by virtue of his sonship. He serves as the covenant mediator. So Robertson will go on to point out Jesus's unique role as son in the book of Hebrews. Because Christ is son, he is king and heir of all things. Hebrews 1, I'm not sure if it's the first verse or second verse. I didn't write it in my notes. But it says that the writer of Hebrews says, he has spoken to us by his son, whom he has appointed heir of all things. And so in this idea of the covenant king, Christ is son, is mediator, is king, is heir of the promises, okay? And we, of course, are fellow heirs with him as his, as being adopted into his family, all right? Also, we see that Christ is the realization of the Davidic promises, right? We've already talked about this some. Robertson says that David's line anticipated in shadow form the eternal character of the reign of Jesus, right? And so there was present realities for David, right? David was king, then his son after him, and so on and so forth. Ultimately, you know, that all falls apart. But there was some present realities, but there were shadows, right? They were just shadows. The ultimate reality was Christ and his eternal reign. Those eternal promises were about Jesus. The human monarchy was a typological representation of the throne of God itself. Robertson says that David's reign was intended to anticipate and shadow form the reality of the Messiah. Robertson says, just as the Levitical priesthood anticipated the abiding priesthood of Jesus, just as Moses in the school of prophets anticipated the prophet par excellence, so David in his throne anticipated the beneficent reign of the coming Messiah. And so Robertson's now tying in the Mosaic covenant with the Davidic covenant into in with Christ. You know, we see Christ as as right priest, prophet, and king. Those are Christ's offices, prophet, priest, and king. He fulfills those offices, and those offices are brought about through the different covenant administrations, okay? And so we see how they all work together, building and building and building, and so we get the fullest picture of Christ. Talking about these quotes, Romans 1, 3 and 4 says, concerning his son who is descended from David according to the flesh, declared to be the son of God in power according to the spirit of holiness by the resurrection from the dead. So again, the line of David, Christ descended from David according to the flesh. Matthew 1:1, the book of the genealogy of Jesus Christ, the son of David. And so it's, again, as we look at the Old Testament, there's a reason why Christ had to have been from the tribe of Judah, right? Because that's what was promised to Jacob. There's a reason why he had to be a son of David, because that's what was promised to David. Okay, and so these promises are all being fulfilled. We see this also in the beginning of Luke's gospel. And the angel said to her, to Mary, do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus. He will be great and be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give to him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. And of his kingdom there will be no end. And so here is the beginning of the fulfillment of all these promises made to David, right? The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David. He will reign over the house forever. Okay? So that's Christ in the Davidic covenant. Again, just like every other covenant, it's all pointing forward to him. Last part of the Davidic covenant we want to look at is faith. Where is faith represented in the Davidic covenant? So in Acts chapter 2, 25-31, this is what it says. For David says concerning him, I saw the Lord always before me, for he is at my right hand, that I may not be shaken. Therefore my heart was glad, and my tongue rejoiced. My flesh also will dwell in hope, for you will not abandon my soul to Hades, or let your Holy One see corruption. For you have made known to me the paths of life. You will make me full of gladness with your presence. Brothers, I may say to you with confidence about the patriarch David that he both died and was buried, and his tomb is with us to this day. Being therefore a prophet, and knowing that God had sworn with an oath to him that he would set one of his descendants on his throne, he foresaw and spoke about the resurrection of the Christ, that he was not abandoned to Hades, nor did his flesh see corruption. And so this scripture is taking a psalm of David, And it's interpreting it as David looking forward and seeing Christ, right? And so, again, years before Christ, David is placing faith in a coming descendant who's going to sit on the throne, and even in his resurrection. We talked about that a little bit with Abraham and Isaac, right? On when God told Abraham to sacrifice Isaac, it said, he believed that God was able even to raise him from the dead, right? And so again, here's faith, not just in a coming king, but in a resurrection, which I think is key. Also, we can see faith in the coming king manifested in a number of other places in the New Testament. I just, pulled a few just as examples of faith in the coming king, the fulfillment of the promises. We see it in the beginning of Matthew's gospel. The wise men are seeking the king of the Jews, right? They come looking for this newborn king, okay? And then also in Luke, this is when Mary and Joseph bring Jesus to the temple to fulfill the rituals and to offer a sacrifice according to what is said in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons. Now there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon, and this man was righteous and devout, waiting for the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit was upon him. And it had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Christ. And so he has been waiting, looking forward to the Christ, right? To the promised Messiah. And so he has placed his faith in this coming Lord who is Jesus. Okay, so that's the Davidic covenant. Sorry. So lastly, as we wrap up the covenant of grace, We want to take a look at the New Covenant, and I really hope that this will be a blessing to you as it was to me as I was studying and reading through these things and preparing for this lesson. So the first thing that I want us to see is that the New Covenant is not new in that it is a completely new creation of a covenant, but in that it is a fulfillment of what was previously spoken in the Old Testament, okay? And so it's not a totally new thing, like we've been saying all along. It's a fulfillment, okay? It's the fuller picture of what has been promised. John T. Rhodes says, the New Covenant is new in the sense of renewed or dramatically changed for the better. It is not a completely new creation unrelated to what came before, okay? And so it's renewed or dramatically changed for the better, all right? Not just something, oh, that didn't work. I gotta try something else, right? It's, remember, we go back to that picture, CFRR, creation, fall, redemption, restoration. It's one plan of redemption. It's one story of redemption, and little by little, it's becoming fuller and fuller and fuller. The flower is opening and opening and more and more. And in the New Covenant, we get to see the full blossom. Robertson says, the New Covenant can be understood in no other way than as a bringing to fruition of that which was anticipated under the Old Covenant. Okay, and so it's a bringing to fruition. Secondly, the New Covenant does not change what was previously promised, but brings fuller and richer blessings, okay? And so kind of the idea in that is, you know, there's things in the New Covenant like, you know, writing the law in your hearts and the Spirit, you know? Those things were realities in the Old Covenant as well, but they're fuller, they're richer. The Spirit, the being indwelt by the Spirit, there's a richer blessing of that within the New Covenant. Lewis Burkhoff writes, the New Testament dispensation brings richer blessings than the Old Testament dispensation. The revelation of God's grace reached its climax when the Word became flesh and dwelt among men, full of grace and truth. The Holy Spirit is poured out upon the church, and out of the fullness of the grace of God in Christ enriches believers with spiritual and eternal blessings. Okay, it's not that the Holy Spirit was not present before, but it's just fuller and richer. Okay. Gerhardus Voss, he also says, as it pertains to the New Covenant, its essence and its benefits are more clearly revealed. It extends to all nations. It no longer has a ceremonial and a typological service. The record of sin that was against us has been destroyed and nailed to the cross. Okay, and so again, New Covenant, it's not completely new creation. It's just bringing in the fuller and richer blessings. Okay, let's look at kind of a background into the New Covenant. So the New Covenant was promised in the Old Testament as Israel is reaping the fullness of the curses brought upon by the breach of the Old Covenant. Okay, so that I took a sip of water. So the New Covenant promise comes as the curses from the Old Covenant is coming upon Israel and Judah. The nations have divided, they're separated, right? And so Israel is already in exile. Judah is about to be in exile or maybe has just entered into exile. And so this is where the New Covenant promise comes in the midst of that. Israel's lost the promised land. They've lost all the things that were promised to them by God. They've lost their land. They've lost the temple. And God, the presence of God is no longer with his people. They've lost their heir of David on the throne, right? They're all in captivity. And so in the midst of all these things going on is when this New Covenant comes. Robertson says, although Israel had failed in fulfilling its covenantal responsibilities, the Lord God of Israel would not fail in his purpose to establish a great people and a great nation to glorify his own name. Although judgment was inevitable, God would establish a new covenant with his people. By means of this covenant relationship, the Lord would bring to certain fruition his commitment to redeem a people to himself. And so even though they failed in fulfilling their responsibilities. God would not fail. His promises would not fail. In fact, it's a part of how he works out his plan of redemption. In the midst of all of this, we see that God offers hope as he promises the new covenant. Okay, so now let's look specifically at the promise of the new covenant. So in the midst of all the curses of Israel losing everything, there come these promises. And so we're going to look at, there's a number of key texts. And so the first one is Jeremiah 31, 34. Behold, the days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. Not like the covenant I made with their fathers on the day when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt. My covenant that they broke, though I was their husband, declares the Lord. For this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days. I will put my law within them. I will write it on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. We see again that covenant formula. And no longer shall each one teach his neighbor and each his brother, saying, know the Lord, for they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, declares the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquity, and I will remember their sin no more. Okay, so that's the first one to look at. So we see a couple things. I will put my law within them. I will write it on their hearts, right? It's not going to be written on tablets of stone anymore. It's going to be written on their hearts. So this is what he's saying now to the people, either as they're in exile or about to be. As they're seeing these curses come upon, they're hearing this promise, right? God, I'm going to make a new covenant with you. You're going to be my people, okay? He's making these promises, again, pointing forward. The second text is in Ezekiel. This is what it says here. I will sprinkle clean water on you, and you shall be clean from all your uncleanness. And from all your idols I will cleanse you. I will give you a new heart, and new spirit I will put within you. I will remove the heart of stone and give you a heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes and be careful to obey my rules. You shall dwell in the land that I gave to your fathers, and you shall be my people, and I will be your God. Okay? So, as a point of emphasis, the point of emphasis is the fuller blessing of the law as it is written on their hearts. And the biggest key is the cleansing of sin. The law has not changed as it pertains to being written on their hearts. It always has, and it still does, reflect the character of God, but it's no longer on stone. Okay, now it's on their hearts. And then, again, I think the key that I really want to emphasize is this new covenant idea of forgiveness of sins. And this is, I think, out of all the different things to look at, this probably is the most important, as it is the fullness of the new covenant. There's going to be a forgiveness of sins. I will remember their sin no more in Jeremiah and in Ezekiel, and you shall be clean from all your uncleanness, right? And so Robertson says that the forgiveness of sins serves as a central feature in the prophetic anticipation of the new covenant. And so, again, he says central feature. So the forgiveness of sins is very important. Robertson points out the constant renewal of sacrifices for sins under the old covenant gives clear indication of the fact that sin actually was not removed, but only passed over. Sin is only removed with the sacrifice of Christ. And so in the old covenant, they always had to make sacrifices constantly, right? And so that points to the idea that sin really wasn't, you know, done away with. You know, we have to keep making these sacrifices. We have to keep making these offerings. And so Hebrews does a good job pointing this out. But in these sacrifices, there is a reminder of sins every year, where it is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. But when Christ had offered for all time a single sacrifice for sins, he sat down at the right hand of God, waiting from that time until his enemies should be made a footstool for his feet. For by a single offering, he has perfected for all time those who are being sanctified. Excuse me. And so, what the blood of bulls and goats could not do, right, Christ does completely. Also, as we look at the forgiveness of sins, as an emphasis in the new covenant, these promises pointing forward to Jesus, Jesus himself refers to the cleansing of sins as it relates specifically to his blood and the new covenant. We see this in Matthew, right? At the Lord's Supper. Now, as they were eating, Jesus took bread, and after blessing it, broke it, and gave it to the disciples, and he said, "Take, eat, this is my body." And he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you, for this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins." And so Jesus ties in this new covenant idea. Now, this specific passage doesn't say new covenant. There's a note in my ESV that some manuscripts have the word new in there. But Jesus refers to his blood, the new covenant, and the forgiveness of sins. Okay. And so all these promises are being fulfilled in Christ and his blood, the new covenant promises. Luke 22 does say new covenant. And likewise, the cup after they had eaten, saying, "This cup that is poured out for you is the new covenant in my blood." And so these promises that were made years ago in the midst of exile, in the midst of losing everything, these new covenant promises, we see Jesus claiming these promises, right? This is the new covenant in my blood. I am establishing this new covenant in my blood. Christ is the key. His death is the key. In his death, he satisfies all the penalties for the violation of every covenant administration. Christ, he became the sacrifice for the curses of the covenant on our behalf. Robertson says, "By bearing the full consequence of the covenantal pledge to death, Christ delivers his people from the curse of the covenant." Okay, and so Christ delivers his people from the curse of the covenant by his pledge to death. I just read that quote, sorry. So after looking at the emphasis of the forgiveness of sins, I want us to see the promise of the Davidic throne. So Ezekiel, again, Old Testament passage looking forward to the new covenant, this is what it says. I think all these things are just really exciting when we see these promises fulfilled in Jesus. "Thus says the Lord God, behold, I will take the people of Israel from the nations among which they have gone, and I will gather them from all around and bring them to their own land, and I will make them one nation in the land on the mountain of Israel. And one king shall be over them, and they shall no longer be two nations." So one nation, one king, right? "My servant David shall be king over them, and they shall all have one shepherd. They shall walk in my rules and be careful to obey my statutes. They shall dwell in the land that I give to my servant Jacob, where your fathers lived. They and their children and their children's children shall dwell there forever. And David, my servant, shall be their prince forever. I will make a covenant of peace with them. It shall be an everlasting covenant with them. And I will set them in their land and multiply them. And I will set my sanctuary in their midst forever. My dwelling place shall be with them. I will be their God, and they shall be my people." Okay, again, covenant formula. I will be their God, and they will be my people. And so there's a number of keys to look at. Okay, one, we see this promise that David will return as a shepherd king. Okay, ultimately, this is fulfilled in Christ, right? John 10:11. Jesus says, "I am the good shepherd," right? The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. So this promise, right, this promise to the exiled people, that this new covenant promise, "My servant David shall be king, and they will have one shepherd." And so the shepherd king promise is fulfilled in Jesus, right, in Christ. The second important thing to see is this idea of this last verse, "My dwelling place shall be with them, and I will be their God, and they will be my people." And if you remember when we talked about, I can't remember if it was the Abrahamic covenant, but this idea of dwelling place and the word tabernacle, how it's the same word used in the Old Testament, the Greek translation of the Old Testament. Jesus, he dwelt or tabernacled with us, right? The word became flesh and dwelt among us, John 1:14. And so that's the idea. That's the fulfillment is in Christ, who came and who dwells with his people, right? The tabernacle, he tabernacles with his people. The presence of God is with us, okay? Just a final note on these Davidic promises. So there was a sort of a short-term reality, right? The remnant was brought back to the land as an immediate fulfillment, and the temple was rebuilt, right? Jerusalem was, the wall was rebuilt. We see that in Ezra and Nehemiah. But the fulfillment, the fullness of the fulfillment of these prophecies are in Christ, right? We as believers, we're currently experiencing the fulfillment of the promises. We are experiencing the forgiveness of the sins and the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. But we're also not yet fully experiencing the fullness of these realities. So there's this already not yet aspect, and we've all heard that before. So in the one hand, they, the people of Israel, experienced the already, right? They got back their land, but it wasn't exactly what it was pointing to. There was a part of that, but the fullness is in Christ. We have the forgiveness of sins, right? Christ has come, he's died, he's been raised. We have the Holy Spirit, and we have the kingdom, but yet we don't fully have it yet. There's this not yet. But we know that Christ is coming, and when he comes, he'll restore his kingdom, the new heavens and the new earth. Sorry about that. So, again, the already, the not yet aspect. In conclusion, just kind of where we've been, we've looked at the Mosaic Covenant. Again, it's a continuation of the covenant of Abraham, points forward to Christ. The Davidic Covenant establishes the kingly line, and then the new covenant promises the fulfillment, right? Where Christ, the forgiveness of sins, that Christ says that this is the new covenant in my blood, right? Forgiveness of sins. And so really that's where we've been. And then of course where we're going to go is to the covenant of redemption next week. Sorry. But just as a final note, I just kind of wanted to point this out. I jotted this down in my notes, but I just think it's really important for us to, as we can better understand our Old Testament scriptures. I've been learning the Old Testament. By no means am I an expert on anything, but probably one of the most beneficial things for me and exciting things for me as a follower of Christ is as I begin to better understand and learn my Old Testament. Sorry. As I better understand the Old Testament, it's helped me to see Christ and to get a better picture of Christ. The Old Testament is filled with Christ. There's so many amazing things to see, like where Jesus is God with us, right? Emmanuel, God with us. He dwells among us. And so, again, just as an encouragement, spend time in the Old Testament seeking Christ. And then also, as we see all of God's promises being fulfilled in Christ, just know that we have this hope that what God has promised will come to pass. One day, Christ is coming to restore all things, right? And so we as we look in the Old Testament, we see that what God has said, he has brought to fruition in the New Testament, okay? And so now we're in the midst of the already not yet. We can look forward and say, okay, what God has promised has come to pass. What God has promised will come to pass for us. He will one day wipe away every tear, and death will be no more. There will be no more mourning or crying or pain. Revelation 22:20 says, he who testifies to these things says, I am coming soon. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. So I pray that this was beneficial to you. And again, if you have any questions, please see, please talk to me, talk to Richard, talk to David. And, we look forward to wrapping up next week and hope you guys have a great weekend. Thanks.